Let's say we have a grid of pixels and we want to draw a circle into it. One algorithm that allows us to solve this problem is called the midpoint circle algorithm. Of course, this doesn't have to be a pixel grid, it could also be a grid of tiles in a tile-based video game, or any other kind of grid. But in our case, we have a grid of pixels, presumably stored in memory. Let's assume it's stored row by row from the top down, meaning our coordinate system starts with 0, 0 in the top left corner. Therefore, the x-coordinate increases to the right, and the y-coordinate increases downwards. Before we can tackle the algorithm, there are some things to note. First, circles are symmetrical. This means we only need to solve the problem for an eighth of the circle, called an octant. We can simply take the resulting pixel coordinates and mirror them for the remainder of the circle. That's going to be very convenient. Second, I will visualize pixel coordinates to be at the center of pixels. I'm doing this for clarity only. Technically, our pixel coordinates can represent the top left corner of pixels, so that's something to be aware of. I just find it more intuitive to have pixel coordinates at the center of each pixel. Anyway, back to our grid of pixels. The circle is of course defined by a position in the grid and a radius. Let's call them CX, CY, which is the center of our circle, and R for the radius. To make our life easier, we're going to use a coordinate system relative to the center of the circle. That means we're going to treat the green pixel here as 0, 0. When we place pixels, we can simply offset the coordinates by CX and CY to make them relative to our entire grid. Okay, let's actually write the algorithm. The draw circle function will have parameters CX, CY, and R. To keep track of the coordinates we're on, let's define variables X and Y. I've decided that we start at 0, negative R. Any other side works equally well, of course, but I simply figured that the top of our circle is a good starting point. To start things off, let's iterate over the number of pixels in a single octant of the circle. We do this by simply iterating for as long as x is below negative y. That is because the end of our octant is reached when we reach the perfect diagonal pixel over here. To make the loop work without repeating infinitely, we of course have to increment x at every iteration. And at every iteration, we place a pixel at xy. Just remember, we need to add CX and CY to the X and Y coordinates to draw the circle at the right location, because X and Y are relative to the center of our circle. So far so good, the function now draws a horizontal line. To curve this line along our circle, we need to decide at each iteration whether we should increment Y by 1. Highlighted here are the two possible pixels at Y and Y plus 1. For this algorithm, we take the point directly between both pixels. We call this the midpoint, which is where the algorithm gets its name. If the midpoint is inside of the circle, we stay on the same pixel. And if the midpoint is outside of the circle, we increment y by 1. Here we can see that the midpoint is inside of the circle, which means that we do not increment y and simply place our pixel here. For the next iteration, we've moved one pixel to the right. Again, the midpoint is inside of the circle, so we continue. And the same thing again for this next pixel. But now things are different. Here the midpoint is outside the circle, so we need to increment our y position, which colors the pixel below. And then we just continue iterating. The next midpoint is back inside the circle, so y will remain the same on this iteration. However, at the next one, the midpoint is outside the circle again. So we increment y. I think you get the idea. We repeatedly check the current midpoint, and when the midpoint goes outside the circle, we increment y. That's all this algorithm does. To calculate the current position of the midpoint, we simply use our current x and y variables, but add 0.5 to the y coordinate. Makes sense, as we move half a pixel down. Back to our code, let's actually calculate the midpoint's y coordinate. I'll store it in this variable called ymid. Now the next question is, how can we check if the midpoint is inside of the circle? Say we have this arbitrary point over here. Our point is defined using its x and y coordinate, right? If we draw these as two lines, and then also draw a line between the center of the circle and the point, we get a right triangle. Let's label the sides of this triangle as a, b, and c. Thanks to the Pythagorean theorem, we know that a squared plus b squared equals c squared. In other words, we can calculate the length of c, which is the square root of a squared plus b squared. But why do we want to know this length? Well, right now, the length of C is longer than the radius. This means our point is outside of the circle. However, if we move the point inside the circle, look what happens. Now C is shorter than the radius. So by checking if C is larger or smaller than the radius, we can determine if the point is inside or outside. Back to our code, we can calculate if the midpoint is inside the circle. We square x and y mid and make sure that the result is larger than r squared. Note that we're not taking the square root here, and instead just compare everything to r squared. This lets us avoid the square root function, which is kind of inefficient. All we have left to do is place pixels in the remaining octants. Currently, this is how we place our pixels. What if instead we place 8 pixels at once, one for each octant? That looks something like this. Essentially, we just mirror our pixel coordinates for every remaining octant. And that's it. We now have a fully working implementation of the midpoint circle algorithm. However, if you find examples of this algorithm online, they look a little different. And that is because what we're doing here isn't very optimal. For example, we're using the value 0.5. Maybe we can get rid of that and just use integers. Granted, these days floating point operations are really fast compared to the time this algorithm was popular, but while we're at it, we might as well get rid of it. Second, we're using quite a few multiplications since we're squaring everything. Ideally, we get rid of multiplications altogether or get them into something like a multiplication by 2, which can be done very efficiently. So let's try and replace these operations with more optimal ones. We'll start by rewriting our condition as the following expression: x squared plus y mid squared minus r squared. This is called the decision parameter, and I'll name it p. Everything is the same as before, except we can now check if p is less than or larger than 0. Less than 0 means it's inside of the circle, and larger means it's outside of the circle, while an exact 0 means we are exactly on the boundary of the circle. Our goal is now to use this expression to figure out our initial value of p, set it before our loop, and then also figure out by how much it must be incremented at every iteration. Let's start with the initial value. What are the values of x and y at the first iteration? Well, as we can see here, we set them to 0 and negative r. So let's set x equal to 0 and y mid equal to negative r plus 0.5 in our expression. Of course, 0 squared is just 0, so we can get rid of it. To simplify the rest of the expression, we'll use this handy formula you may remember from school. A plus b squared equals a squared plus 2ab plus b squared. As both of these expressions are identical, we can substitute them for one another. And as it turns out, negative r plus 0.5 squared is in this exact configuration. Except here, a is negative r and b is 0.5. Converting all this into the equivalent expression up here gives us the following. Next, negative r squared is the same as r squared, as two negatives multiplied result in a positive. This r squared and negative r squared then cancel each other out. 2 times negative r times 0.5 is just the same as negative r, and of course 0.5 squared is 0.25. But remember, we wanted to try and only use integers. How do we get rid of this 0.25? One way is to just erase it. This makes our initial p-value an approximation, but it remains pretty close to what it's supposed to be. I did some testing, and as far as I can tell, this does actually make a slight difference in how the circle is drawn. It's not something that's actually noticeable from like a zoomed out perspective, but if you zoom in pixel by pixel, you can tell a difference. So that's something to be aware of. Anyway, if we get rid of 0.25, we're left with our initial p-value of negative r. This may seem like a lot of steps to arrive at such a simple value, but I wanted to make sure you see how we get there. Especially because depending on how you structure the algorithm, you may need a different initial value. Most examples you find online actually calculate the p-value for the next pixel. And therefore they begin this step by inserting a 1 for the x-coordinate. Simplifying this expression eventually leaves us with 1.25 minus r, or 1 minus r if we just used integers. I don't think one of these is better than the other, I just found that the way we've done it first is more intuitive. But maybe there's an advantage to the second approach that I'm not seeing. Let me know in the comments if there is one. Anyway, let's go back to our code and add our initial value of p to the function. The beginning of the function looks the same as before. But then we define p with its initial value of negative r. Then comes our while loop, and at every iteration we now check if p is larger than 0. Remember, this just means the midpoint is outside the circle. If so, we increment y by 1. Finally, we draw all octants pixels and increment x at every iteration. However, one piece is still missing to actually make this algorithm work again. We need to update p at every iteration by some amount. And of course, this amount differs depending on whether we move down by a pixel or not. Let's start by calculating the amount needed when y does not increase. Again, we begin with our variable p, which is just x squared plus y mid squared minus r squared. And y mid is of course y plus 0.5. Now, like I said, in this situation, our y coordinate is not increasing, but of course our x coordinate is still increasing because it increases on every iteration. So if we wanted to calculate the next p value, it would be at x plus 1 squared plus y plus 0.5 squared minus r squared. Our goal is to figure out how to get from p to p next. That's the amount we increment by. To get this amount, we simply take the difference by subtracting p from p next. We can then substitute each variable with its expression to get this mess we can simplify. First, we get rid of the parentheses by inverting the signs inside of them. We see that the highlighted terms are both added and subtracted, so they cancel each other out. Next, we can rewrite x plus 1 squared as x squared plus 2x times 1 plus 1 squared. X squared then gets cancelled out. Finally, we multiply everything out and arrive at 2x plus 1. So that's how much p increases when the y coordinate is not incremented. Let's fill that into our function. All that remains is finding out by how much p increases in the other case, where y has been incremented. First, we grab our p and p next expressions again. Now, if you remember our code, y has already been incremented at this point, which means our p next expression is already the next p value. But our p expression is wrong, as y has already been increased. Subtracting 1 gives us the proper current p value, and that's it. We just need to simplify this expression like we did earlier. Let's again get rid of the parentheses. R squared is cancelled out. We rewrite x plus 1 squared. X squared cancels itself out. We expand y plus 0.5 squared. And finally, we expand y minus 0.5 squared. For this, we need a slightly different formula. Then we get rid of these parentheses and also get rid of like terms again. After all this, we're left with 2x plus 1 plus y plus y. Of course, we can also rewrite that as 2x plus 1 plus 2y, which is the same as 2 times x plus y plus 1. And there we go. Let's fill that into our function as well. Perfect. This is our finished implementation. Of course, this is not the only way to draw a circle. There are other algorithms that are very similar to this one, but slightly different. It's also worth mentioning that we can draw filled circles using these algorithms. When placing pixels, we can simply draw perfect horizontal lines for pairs of pixels that have the same y-coordinate. But implementing that is pretty trivial at this point, so I won't waste your time. Thank you for watching, and I hope you learned something.